Quarto Audio presents Atlas of Improbable Places, written and read for you by Travis Elborough. To my wife, Emily, for joining me on the journey. Introduction. Maps, the great Italian writer Italo Calvino once maintained, presupposed the idea of a narrative, because they are conceived on the basis of a journey, an odyssey. The earliest need to fix place on stone, skin, or primitive paper was fundamentally linked to travel, and the earliest cartographers looked to the sky rather than the earth for their starting points of reference. Today, heavenly bodies arguably still guide us as we take directions from GPS systems beaming information from satellites orbiting our planet. But the gulf between the age of the sextant and the wooden sailing ship, when so much of the world remained uncharted territory, and our satellite navigation-enabled present seems impossibly vast. To travel back then was often to embark on a journey into the unknown, with the final destination vague, or the subject of wild speculation, if not outright fiction, and one which the voyager might never reach, let alone return from. We are, of course, the lucky beneficiaries of such sometimes suicidal pioneering expeditions. Places that were once the stuff of dreams and improbable to the point of implausibility are as accessible and now almost as familiar to us as our own neighbourhoods. Though that is not without its downsides entirely. Few of us believe the world is flat, but an hour or so on Google Maps or TripAdvisor surveying an increasingly interconnected and corporately globalised planet can definitely make us feel that it is flatter, or at least rather less fantastical and strange than it was for our ancestors. A case of here be dragons on the far corner of a sketchily drawn map, giving way to here be some well-known brands and chain shops flagged upon arrival on your phone's app. It was Calvino again who, over 40 years ago, in Invisible Cities, presciently invented a fictional metropolis called Trude, whose overwhelming characteristic is that it is exactly the same as everywhere else. If on arriving at Trude I had not read the city's name written in big letters, the story's narrator states, I would have thought I was landing at the same airport from which I had taken off. At the end of the tale, his traveller, bored by Trude's similarity with so many other places, begs to leave, but is informed that they will only arrive at another Trude, absolutely the same, detail by detail. The world is covered by a sole Trude, which does not begin and does not end, only the name of the airport changes. But claims about the growing, soul-crushing similarity of places can be overstated, as hopefully this volume illustrates. Thankfully, the world continues to be a dizzyingly diverse place. Our appetite for the unusual and the out of the ordinary has, if anything, only been heightened by new technology, the scanning and sharing of fresh information and imagery, themselves a spur to further travel. And post-industrialization, changing the kinds of places we find intriguing, beautiful, or worthy of cursory investigation. When almost every action we perform online is tracked and all things digital attempt to distance us from the body and physical disintegration, it is perhaps not so surprising that our fascination with the utterly abandoned, the long unobserved, the decayed and the ruin has increased exponentially. That picture of a weed-infested factory or decaying mansion in Detroit or St. Louis, say, will frequently have their greatest currency on Instagram or other social media sites, only reaffirms, rather than contradicts, a particular contemporary desire to seek out the obscure and the unburnished. The Atlas of Improbable Places, then, is intended as a compendium of unlikely, curious, and plain odd locales. The improbability factor, if you will, of each of these places was that they were distinguished by some element of their architecture, natural geography, or present or past state of being. Improbability may have been inherent at the beginning, or thrust upon them later, or only accrued in recent times. But these places all have stories to tell us. The map may not be the territory, just as written history is not the sum of any individual place. But ideally, we need to read them both to reach a greater understanding of where we are and where we might be going. Dream Creations. Flevopolder, the region reclaimed from the sea. Lelystad, Netherlands. Latitude, 52 degrees, 30 minutes and 0 seconds north. Longitude, 5 degrees, 28 minutes and 0 seconds east. For nearly 2,000 years, the occupants of what is today the Netherlands have been locked into an almost Sisyphean battle to hold back and reclaim land from the sea. Traces of this struggle can be detected in the remains of ancient terpen or earth mounds that still survive in certain parts of the country. Dating from around 500 BC, these edifices, along with earthen dikes, served as the most basic bulwark against flooding for the earliest settlers to these often sodden lands. But such defences alone could hardly be expected to halt the advances of a rampaging North Sea. And a series of particularly savage storms in the 11th and 12th centuries led to the deaths from drowning of tens of thousands and water permanently claiming huge swathes of the northern coast. One beneficiary of these topographical changes, however, was the estuary town of Amsterdam, which suddenly found itself with the direct route to the ocean and subsequently developed into a major port and finally wound up as the capital city. Still, the story of this country, over half of which presently lies below sea level, is as much about land gain as loss. God, it is said, may have created the world, but the Dutch gave the world the Netherlands. Around 10% of the country is made up of bits that were once underwater. And much of the rest of it would be too, but for an extensive network of canals, dams, drains and dikes that were begun in the Middle Ages. By the 15th century, the Dutch had developed a highly sophisticated hydro-engineering system, one that involved using encircling dikes and water-pumping windmills, hence their ubiquity in this landscape, to drain quite substantial tranches of saturated ground and complete ponds, rivers and lakes. The resulting drain lands, known as polders, could then be used for farming and building on. This technique would reach its pinnacle in the latter half of the 20th century with the creation of Flevoland, a cluster of polders that make up the Netherlands' 12th and newest province. It's also the world's largest artificial island. Flevoland represents the fulfillment of an ambition long held by Dutch civil engineers to tame the Zuider Zee, or South Sea. Once an estuary of the River Rhine, it had, through storms and by a process of natural erosion, become an inland sea that seemed bent on only further extending its extent. The first proposal to close it off and drain the land came in 1667 from the pioneering hydrologist Heinrich Steven, who stated his objective as being to rid the Netherlands of the fury and the poison of the North Sea, together with all the brackish waters from Zealand, Holland and West Friesland. His dream, alas, came to nothing, and the idea was shelved until the 19th century, when steam-powered water pumps looked set to make his idea a much more viable proposition. But nearly 30 plans were published before the baton was picked up in the 1890s by Cornelius Lilly. A former student of engineering at the Polytechnic School of Delft, Lilly was the Minister of Transport and Water Management, who prepared several technical reports and became a fervent advocate for a reclamation scheme. Nevertheless, government approval was granted only in the wake of another terrible flood in 1916. and the first stage of the Zuiderzee works started in 1920 when construction began on the Alsley Dyke. This 19-mile-long dyke was to connect...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.